Forget about quantum mechanics for a second. Forget about all of our physical theories. Let's do a Library of Babel version of the universe. So maybe people are familiar with this fictional idea of the Library of Babel. This is this. This is not the exact version of the story. It's going to be the version that I'm going to use. Okay, there's a vast library, and you enter the library, and what you see is all the books. Right, that begin with what was it? You see a bunch of doors. I'm sorry, a bunch of doors labeled by different letters. You go through the letter T, the door labeled T, and then inside is every single book that could possibly exist that begins with letter T. And then what you do is you go through the door labeled H, and if you go through that door, there's every single book that begins with the letters TH. And this way, you can just sort of find your way. You can write or find every book that could ever be written by just going through a sequence of doors, and this library contains all of them. And someone says, this gives an account of the universe. I mean, after all, we just look at the entire library, and somewhere in there is going to be a universe that looks like ours. But you look at that and go, that's completely vacuous. That doesn't contain any interesting information, right? What we want is a theory that in some way says some constraints about what kinds of universes are going to happen and which aren't. And two of the problems of the many worlds approach is that it contains so many different kinds of universes that are so radically different. And one of the when you read about people who write about the many worlds interpretation, I mean, in the last podcast I did with you, Curt, I had this long explanation of the problems of the many worlds approach. One problem that I didn't mention in that conversation, but that comes up in the literature, is people don't take it seriously enough. So when Bryce DeWitt in 1970 published his article in Physics Today, this is 13 years after Everett's PhD thesis in 57, announcing and broadcasting what Bryce DeWitt called the many worlds interpretation to the wider physics community. I believe the article was called Quantum Mechanics and Reality. It was in Physics Today. He talks about how there are branches that are sort of reasonable looking in some sense. And there are also these branches that are kind of at the edges of the probability, the tails of the probability distribution that are weird, and weird things happen in them. I don't remember if in that article he introduces the term maverick branches for those, but eventually these became known as maverick branches. But when you read the literature in many worlds, people who, and now I'm going to get kind of technical, people who use what's called Dutch book reasoning to argue how you can get probabilities out, they still stay within these sort of narrow confines of ordinary looking branches and maybe maverick branches. But if you take the many worlds picture seriously, you have to consider branches that are even more bizarre than the branches that conform to whatever game is being played. I call these super maverick branches. You know, they're just maverick branches, but they're branches in which whatever rules you're trying to set up for the game you want to play and use the branches to explain, there are branches in which the rules don't apply because something totally zany happens. Apparently, and once you include all the super maverick branches, you're basically in the Library of Babel situation where you're explaining everything and you're not putting constraints on which kinds of worlds we expect to see. And there aren't the resources in the many worlds interpretation to like narrow down to worlds that at least look somewhat like the ones we see among all the possibilities. That's a major problem.
So certainly I agree that, you know, if a theory doesn't rule anything out, you know, if it doesn't tell us that anything is impossible or at least, you know, vanishingly unlikely, you know, then it's vacuous, right? Then it's not doing anything for us, right? You know, and this is why this is part of why I have never been a hardcore many worlder, right? Like, you know, I will use it pedagogically when it is useful for me. Like, you know, one example of where I've found it, you know, indispensable is when I am teaching quantum computing, right? And I need to explain how, like, it is possible to take a qubit, you know, do a what we call a C not gate, a controlled not gate, right? Like, write the result of the qubit somewhere else, sort of copy its state to a different qubit, and now the effect on the first qubit is exactly as if someone had measured it, right? It is decohered from the perspective of someone who now looks only at the first qubit, right? And students get incredibly confused about that. They're like, you know, why is that, right? They feel like, you know, it's still a superposition, right? And like the one explanation that I can give them that seems to click, that seems to work, is to say, look, you might as well say, if you wanted, that the qubit was measured. It's just that it was measured by the other qubit. You know, the other qubit did the measurement. And you might as well say that when you measure, right, what does that mean when you measure? It's just that there's a giant C-naught gate that is happening from that qubit to you, to the possible states of your brain, of your measuring device, of your environment, right? You know, to me, that is the core of what, you know, Evredianism is saying. You know, it is sort of the best way to explain that. Right. And it is true that, I am ultimately not satisfied by a theory that doesn't account for my experience of the world. Right. Because, you know, as Democritus said in that famous dialogue, you know, in 400 BC, like, how can you, you know, ignore the senses when it's from the senses that you get your evidence? Right. You know, how can we ignore our own experience when our experience is the only reason why we believe quantum mechanics in the first place? Right. So I would say that, like, with some, you know, I think, you know, fairly, you know, reasonable sounding additional assumptions about, you know, what observers are, how, you know, observers connect to the physical world. Like, yeah, I can get something like that looks like the standard quantum mechanical predictions, you know, out of the Evredian picture, but it is not automatic. You know, I agree that it's not automatic. You know, I don't believe any of the, you know, so-called derivations of the Born rule, you know, of the probabilities from many worlds, you know, for neither Everett's original derivation nor any of the later ones. I feel like, you know, they all sneak in some additional assumption. But I would also say that that's not just a problem for many worlds. I would say that, you know, in any account of quantum mechanics, at some point you're going to have this problem. Where did the Born rule come from, right? Where did probabilities come from, you know, if you didn't want to have probabilities in your fundamental picture? Of course, Jacob, in your account, you do have probabilities.
Yes, you do, right?
In your fundamental picture, right?
Yeah.
But, you know, if you have an initially deterministic picture, then you're always going to have that problem. So, yeah. So
it's a good reason not to have a deterministic picture. I mean, it's like
I agree that, you know, yeah, there are pluses and minuses to, you know, all the different, you know, major interpretations. You know, then you know there are other ones where I only see minuses. We don't have to talk about those maybe, but you know, that's why, you know, I don't own a car. I just, you know, take Ubers, if you like. I just, you know, drive different cars as the need arises. You know, I could imagine some future circumstance when, you know, I would want to use Jacob's car, right? I could imagine, you know, if it helps with quantum gravity.
Scott, you can borrow my car whenever you want.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. That's so kind of you. Look, if it helps with, you know, understanding a quantum algorithm, you know, I am ready to, you know, take a ride in whichever car will get me to where I'm going. You know, right now I don't see where, you know, what this car is going to get me, you know, where I couldn't already get. But, you know, I like to keep an open mind.
Let me say a couple of quick things just to follow up about that.
Yeah. Okay.
So this is one of the annoying places where I'm going to be the annoying philosopher. I'm sorry. But, you know, one of the things that philosophers like to do is take a claim, an idea, and really drill down on it and make sure that it really works when you follow it to all of its sort of logical conclusions. When you said, well, if I just have the Schrodinger equation and it's just evolving, it's a wave function, and that's going to be good enough, you'll notice that quickly we ran into problems as I was probing that, because I asked you, well, how do we exactly do this? And you're like, well, kind of like this. And then I pointed out this problem with all these weird branches and we're saying too much. And then you're like, well, we add a few more assumptions and so forth. One of the selling points of the many worlds approach is that it is so simple. I mean, just take the Schrodinger equation and unitary evolution and maybe one or two more things. I have a book on my desk. You can sort of see it. It's sitting there right in front of my Einstein doll. It's called Stone Soup. And I think this gives a fantastic metaphor for what happens in an approach like the many worlds interpretation. So those of you who don't know the Stone Soup folktale, these soldiers arrive at a very skeptical town and claim that they can make a delicious, hearty soup out of just water and stones. And the townspeople are amazed by this, and they give them a pot and they start boiling the water. And as they're making the boiling the water, they're like, you know, this is already great, but you know, it'd be even better if we have a little bit of seasoning. And so the townspeople come, they add some seasoning, and they're like, oh, this is already almost perfect, but you know, it'd be even better with a little bit of vegetables. And then the townspeople vegetables. And then by the end, they have this, you know, obviously they've added vegetables and seasoning and meat and broth and all kinds of things. And the townspeople are eating it. And then there's this line in some tellings of the story where one amazed townsperson who wasn't sort of paying attention says, gosh, all this from just water and stones. The many worlds interpretation.
So, Jacob, in your account, the equation for the trajectories would be the meat and the vegetables that need to be added.
But I'm very clear up front, right? I'm telling you exactly what the ingredients are. We're not going through, and we're, you know, and I say this in the podcast with Curt, right? To get many worlds off the ground, at least to attempt to get it off the ground, you have to add more and more of these postulates. And I think, I mean, I don't know, Scott, how much of the literature you've read in many worlds, but like the number of additional assumptions you need to add is quite large. And a lot of them are very esoteric, metaphysical, very difficult to imagine how we would ever verify that they in fact work. So I call this the stone soup problem. And I think it's actually a pretty serious problem with many worlds approach. But fundamentally, I don't believe it can work. And Scott, you noted this. You said that the derivations of the Born rule out of the many worlds approach, you don't believe any of them. And I agree with you. And I laid out my reasons for skepticism in the podcast I did interview with Curt recently. But I actually think it's worse than that. Because you might say is, well, maybe we can't derive probability or derive the Born rule. So let's just agree that it's going to be an extra axiom that we add, right? Because this is one route that I know some people take. They're just like, well, you know, if I can't derive probability ab initio without probabilistic assumptions, let's just do many worlds and then we'll see all these universes and we'll somehow attach probabilities to them, say that some are likely, some are unlikely.
There are extremely strong arguments that if you are going to assign probabilities to the branches at all, then any rule for doing that other than the Born rule is going to lead you into nonsense.
These arguments, by the way, show up in Everett's original dissertation, right? Even in the shorter version of his dissertation, the one that was
there are many different arguments that all lead to that same conclusion.
There are many different arguments. But here's the problem. Okay, so if your view was that the branches were fundamental things, that is, they're like the branches themselves are part of the, are considered fundamental ingredients, then it is completely fine in an axiomatic theory to assign them in the axioms things like probabilities. And this is, for example, what happens in stochastic versions of Bohmian mechanics or what happens in stochastic collapse theories or whatever, right? I mean, if you're taking certain things to be part of your fundamental ingredients, you're allowed to assign them features in your fundamental ingredients. The problem is that in order to get around this preferred basis problem of the many worlds approach, there's infinitely many bases we could use and what singles out one basis over the other. The idea is that we rely on this the dynamical decoherence process for macro worlds to sort of pick out these approximate macroscopic worlds. Problem is that if your branches are only showing up in an approximate way in later stages of the development of the theory, you can't assign them axiomatic features like probabilities in the axioms. It would be like taking a theory of chemistry, saying I've got an axiomatic theory of chemistry in which in some situations you end up with tables and chairs, and I'm going to assign properties to the tables and chairs in my axioms of chemistry. Like, you can't do that. The axioms have to apply to the fundamental ingredients.
What people like Deutsch and Wallace try to do then is they say, well, look, you know, we have observers within the many worlds context. They should act as if the probabilities are the Born probabilities. This is what rational decision theory means in that context. And this is then what we mean by probabilities in that context. Right. So I agree that you have to give
that doesn't work.
The probability.
Well, it doesn't work. I mean, and I talked in my podcast with Curt. I don't know if I want to rehash all those arguments.
Yeah.
But those arguments are all logically circular, right? Because you can't just say, well,
I mean,
because you use the word should. You should be a rational observer. I don't know what should means. In the many worlds universe, there are just zillions of uncountably many parallel worlds with uncountably many copies of observers in them who do all kinds of things.
All of these arguments are, you know, have to, you know, have some starting point, right? Like I agree that none of them can get you know, something out of nothing.
But you can't derive probability from them.
None of them can get soup from purely a stone. Okay.
Exactly.
But,
right.
You know, to be fair, there is enormous precedent in the history of physics for, you know, making the fundamental ingredients of your theory, you know, as simple as possible, you know, even, you know, like impossibly simple, you know, just atoms in the void, right?
Agreed.
Just, you know, a bunch of particles undergoing. So, you know, and then, you know, and then someone might say, okay, but this doesn't work because you don't have tables and chairs and trees in your fundamental ontology. And you say, like, no, that's a misunderstanding. You know, we don't actually need that at all. All of that is derivable. You know, all of that is to be explained from these very simple building blocks, right? I mean, that is, you know, I think that's the goal. Now I agree that you know, to explain the experience of an observer, it seems like, you know, something is missing. There's some additional ingredient that's missing, you know, and maybe, you know, I feel like, speaking of going around in circles, and maybe we are at this point, you know, I think one place where you and I strongly agree is that, you know, saying that you can ask this question and it just, you know, I can't give you an answer, or, you know, no answer is presently knowable. That is an improvement over saying you're not allowed to ask.
New update, started a Substack. Writings on there are currently about language and ill-defined concepts, as well as some other mathematical details. Much more being written there. This is content that isn't anywhere else. It's not on Theories of Everything. It's not on Patreon. Also, full transcripts will be placed there at some point in the future. Several people ask me, hey, Curt, you've spoken to so many people in the fields of theoretical physics, philosophy, and consciousness. What are your thoughts? While I remain impartial in interviews, this Substack is a way to peer into my present deliberations on these topics. Also, thank you to our partner, The Economist.